You're listening to The Voluntary Life, where you can hear ideas for finding freedom in an unfree world. Visit thevoluntarylife.com to connect with the show and hear all past episodes. Here's your host, Jake.
Hi, it's Jake here. Welcome to The Voluntary Life. This week's episode is about crowdsourcing feedback, and I'm going to tell you about how I crowdsource feedback in the writing of my new book, Job Free. So I'd like to tell you about my new book and about all of the technology and workflows and lessons I've learned from the process of crowdsourcing feedback. It's been an awesome experience for me, and I got a huge amount out of it, which I will explain to you. And I think this is the kind of approach that you could use in your own writing projects, but also in other projects too. This way of getting feedback is really helpful, and it's provided me with awesome benefits in the writing of my new book. So that's what I'm going to tell you about this week. So I'll start off by telling you a little bit about the book itself. My new book is called Job Free: 4 Ways to Quit the Rat Race and Achieve Financial Freedom on Your Terms. And it has just been published on Amazon. I'll put a link in the show notes, but you can also get it at getbook.at/jobfree. That's getbook.at/jobfree. That will take you directly to your local Amazon store. I've just published the book and I've already got 13 reviews. And they're great reviews, and I'm really happy about that. Reviews are super important. So rather than tell you my opinion of the book, I'm going to read you a little bit from some of the first reviews. This is an anonymous review, and the reviewer says, "This book is an excellent resource for those who are looking for more out of life than just your standard 9-to-5 until 65. It's the only book I've read that discusses more than just one way to achieve financial freedom. My wife and I are in our mid to late 20s, and we're in the category of extreme savers. We've learned from Jake through his book and podcast, The Voluntary Life, how to find a balance between saving, spending, and happiness. When we first started the journey of pursuing a job-free lifestyle, we set certain savings goals that would allow us to have a little more freedom in job choices. I'm happy to say that thanks to the skills we've learned from Jake, my wife was able to leave her stressful job and move to a career that's far more fulfilling. I highly recommend Jake's podcast as well, because it's a great resource for those looking to quit the rat race. Thank you very much." This next review is from Jolt, and he says, "This book is probably the best resource on the market right now for anyone devising a strategy to quit the rat race somewhere down the line. Rather than getting lost in details, it gives you all the essentials so you can compare these 4 different ways and pick the one that's most likely to work for you. Reading this will save you a lot of time you'd spend trying to find the best books on each topic it covers. But Job Free goes way further than just comparing different strategies and philosophizing about them. It provides actionable steps that you can take and put into practice straight away. Excellent work, highly recommended. Thank you." And I'll read one more. This is from Emily, and she writes, "In 3 words, accessible, actionable, inspiring. Having been a long-time listener of Jake's podcast, I really enjoyed seeing the ideas crystallize into book format. Would definitely recommend for newcomers to the idea of financial freedom. Yes, it is actually achievable. And long-time followers of Jake's work. One thing uniquely valuable about this book is that it doesn't take a one-size-fits-all approach to financial freedom, but presents a diversity of strategies that will appeal to people from lots of different backgrounds in life. When I imagine the path to a flourishing world of autonomous individuals interacting and collaborating voluntarily, I see books like this paving the way. Thank you." So those are just a few of the reviews to give you a flavor of what my book is about. I'll just explain briefly why I wrote it. I wanted to write this book to show you that you can achieve a job-free life and that you have options about how to do it. You know, my previous book, Becoming an Entrepreneur, was about my own journey through entrepreneurship. And that's how I achieved financial independence. But not everyone believes that they can be an entrepreneur. Regardless of whether or not that's the case, it's definitely true that some people just don't want to be an entrepreneur. So I wanted to write a book that showed you all the options for how you can live a life free of jobs and find more financial freedom in your life. And this book is not a book about how you can live like me. It's a book that gives you the options and shows you the pros and cons. And I have given my own opinions about what I think are the pros and cons of different lifestyle choices so that you can really find a lifestyle that suits you and enables you to live free of jobs. Even if you think you know a lot about one way to quit the rat race and achieve financial freedom, you may not know much about the other routes. And this book brings them all together. So it's designed for beginners, but I think even if you already have some experience in these topics, you'll find stuff that that you haven't heard before. I did a lot of research for this book. In many ways, it's kind of a culmination of all of the work that I've done on the voluntary life over the last 5 years. Many of the interviews and podcasts that I've done have been brought together in this book. And I really started working on it 2.5 years ago when I did a presentation called 4 Ways to Quit the Rat Race, which I will put a link in the show notes to that. But I then did a lot more work after that presentation, taking examples of real world people who have managed to quit the rat race on their own terms and using these examples to show you the options that are available to you. So there are 17 original in-depth interviews that are quoted in the book. Beyond those original interviews, I also read 36 books in this field and looked at countless websites. And that all led to over 500 pages of background notes that I wrote for this book. But in the end, I condensed the book way down to it's just 100 pages. And that was partly through the process of the feedback that I got on the book. But I wanted to just explain a little bit about what the book is and what the background is, so that I can now tell you about how I crowdsourced feedback, because that's the process that I think you could apply on your own projects, which has worked really well for me and has been a fascinating experience in its own right as well. So I wanted to get feedback on my book from listeners and also from other people who are interested in financial independence and entrepreneurship and ways to quit the rat race. And this is something that I did for my previous book, Becoming an Entrepreneur, but I sort of took it to the next level with this book, Job Free. And the main tool that I used was to ask people to be beta readers for the draft of my book. So I made an announcement on my podcast, and I also contacted people on some relevant forums, and I got 165 listeners and interested people who wanted to read the draft of my book. And that was over 3 times more than I had for Becoming an Entrepreneur, my previous book. So that was really great to see that level of interest. And of those 165, I got 85 people who gave me back detailed feedback on the book. That's over 50% of the people who took the draft, gave me detailed, marked up manuscripts with detailed notes. And I've said this to all the beta readers already, but I will just say again in this podcast, I'm so grateful for that feedback. It has been really helpful. I'm blown away by the intelligence and the kindness of listeners who gave me so much feedback on the book, and it's had a huge impact on the book itself. And my listeners are super intelligent, fascinating people, a really diverse group. I had all age ranges in this feedback, and I had people from all walks of life. It's been fascinating for me to see, you know, to get more of an insight into my listeners. You guys are awesome, and I really appreciate your support. So that was the crowd that I had for this crowdsourcing, a group of 165 listeners, which then came down to 85 listeners who provided detailed feedback on my manuscript. But the question is, what do you do with feedback from 85 people? How do you actually take that on board in a useful way to improve the book? So this is where I want to tell you a little bit about some of the tools that I used to make sense of the feedback. So the first thing that I did was I received the feedback back in Microsoft Word files. I'd given out my manuscript as a Microsoft Word document, and the beta readers had gone through and marked up using the track changes feature in Microsoft Word, which makes it very easy to find everything that they've commented on and suggested changes to and so forth. And the first thing I did was I read through each of the Word documents as they came back, and I looked at the comments and revisions, and I pulled out what's called the developmental edits. So when you have someone providing feedback on a document, you can think of it in terms of developmental edits and copy edits and proofreading. And developmental edits are the big picture ideas about, you know, whether or not a whole section makes sense, or whether you should change the structure, or how you should change the tone, and these kind of more big picture comments. And then you have copy edits, which are, you know, typos and grammar and rewording and so forth. So I found it really helpful to make a distinction between the developmental edits and the copy edits, and I treated them differently. And what I did for the developmental edits is I actually put them into a piece of bug tracking software. So this is very much taking some of my experience from developing software. I used a bug tracking tool to track big picture suggestions from the beta readers as bugs. And what that allowed me to do was to see how many beta readers were making the same suggestions for bigger picture developmental edits. So here's an example of a developmental edit that I got from the beta readers. Many people said they really liked the outline of the four different ways to quit the rat race, four strategies for living a job-free life. That's great, but they wanted more guidance on how to choose between these four different ways. Because when I wrote the original draft of this book, I basically just presented, you know, here's four ways that you can quit the rat race, and they're all different, they've got pros and cons, there you go. And I got feedback from a lot of people that that's great, but I want more guidance on how do I choose between these four different ways. And that was very helpful because I hadn't really thought about it in those terms. I'd been focused on presenting the options, but what I was able to do was take on board that feedback and write a new chapter on how do you make the choice between these four different job-free lifestyles? How do you decide which one is right for you and in which stage of life it may be right for you? And I think the addition of that chapter has massively improved the book, and it's a really helpful chapter, I think. So that's an example of the kind of developmental edit that I was getting from beta readers that I wanted to evaluate and see how many people made that same suggestion and how many people made other suggestions. And I had 65 bugs like that, which I tracked, some of which had, you know, just one person had suggested and others had multiple people suggesting. And that enabled me to see, you know, well, how strong is the feedback that I'm getting on these different topics? And it's not to say that I only made changes where I had multiple people suggesting them. Sometimes if I just thought something's a very good idea, I would do it. But if I only had one person suggesting out of a total of 85, then that already gives me some useful feedback about, you know, what to do with this suggestion. And I used a bug tracking tool on the Mac, a very simple one called Crash Site. I think it was free is the reason I used that one. But it just allowed me to put in each of the bugs, and it allowed me to categorize them so I could choose whether these were things that I wasn't going to change, or I did want to change, or I'd already corrected, and that kind of thing. Very simple piece of software. There's loads of other bug tracking tools out there, but I found that helpful as a way of handling the developmental edits. So that was the developmental edits, the big picture changes. But I also had a huge amount of feedback from the beta readers in the text itself. I had these marked up Microsoft Word documents with loads of track changes, revisions shown. These were more detailed comments on, you know, the choice of words and typos and things like that. And I found a great way of making use of this feedback productively. In Microsoft Word, you can combine revisions. So if you have a number of changes tracked by different people, you can combine them all into one document with all of the track changes, comments, and revisions from each person in one single document. And this is what I was able to do with 85 Microsoft Word documents. I actually pulled them all together. I didn't get them into one because for various technical reasons, it was easier to have, I had about three or four versions of the manuscript with beta reader comments combined into these three or four versions. And what that enabled me to do is to go through and rather than read revisions in each individual manuscript and go through 85 times, I was able to see all of the comments and revisions on every paragraph at once, or almost at once. I had a couple of documents, but I was able to see them all together. And that was very helpful because it enabled me to see which parts of the text there were lots of feedback and comments on and how many people had identified the same sections and suggested changes to them, and even where lots of people had queried or made multiple questions about something. And that was really helpful because it enabled me to get all of the useful copy edits and grammar and typos and corrections, but not be completely overwhelmed by having to read through 85 different versions of my manuscript. I could combine it all together and just go through and accept or reject changes. And I actually kept the manuscript itself in the application Scrivener that I use, which is a writing program, because that has a lot better tools for writing than Word. But Microsoft Word was very helpful for this process of combining revisions and combining this crowdsourced feedback together. And it provided new information. As I said, it meant that the whole was larger than the sum of its parts because I could see where there were clusters of comments and so forth. So I really recommend that if you're going to get feedback on a document, try using Microsoft Word's track changes feature and then combining the comments, and you can see more information about how different comments overlap and how similar they are to each other and so forth. So that was how I dealt with the copy edits and proofreading. I did, of course, also finally hire a professional copy editor to go through the very final version of the document and just pick out any last errors that hadn't been picked up. But I just wanted to explain the crowdsourced element of that feedback and how I used it. And another thing that I did to get crowdsourced feedback was to use polling of beta readers. Basically, I wanted to present different options that I had for both the title and the cover design of this book, and essentially do a poll and see what kind of feedback I got on voting from beta readers. So I presented beta readers with a couple of title options and asked them to email me back. And that one I just did as an email poll, which was fairly straightforward. And then on the cover design, I used a company called 99 Designs to run a design competition. And I had 80 cover designs. And from those 80 designs, I ran two polls. And the first poll I used to really choose a basic design direction from the vast number that I had. And the second poll was to choose more detailed things like the color and so forth. So really, this book has benefited massively from crowdsource feedback. I've had feedback on the text, both at the developmental edit stage and in detail. I've had feedback on the title. I've had feedback on the cover. And you could also say that I've had feedback on the ideas at a very detailed level too, because this book has brought together all the work that I've done on the podcast, and I've been able to benefit from getting feedback on individual podcasts over the last 5 years, which have helped me to hone those ideas and pull them together in this book. I thought I'd finish by just outlining some of the really interesting things to look out for if you want to do crowdsourcing feedback of this kind. One thing that I've found really helpful in this whole process is to try to prevent cross-influence in your feedback. What you want to do is get as much genuine feedback from diverse individuals as possible. The best way to do that is to get individual feedback from lots of people rather than get a group feedback as a kind of debate. So for example, I had a lot of people asking me why I didn't use something like Google Docs to get feedback on my manuscript, because everybody could have made their comments in one document. But the problem with that is that when beta readers can see each other's comments, then you have the risk that the person who is best at expressing their opinions starts to influence the views of other people. And then you actually lose some feedback because you're not getting everyone's own opinions. You're getting kind of like the group consensus. It's much more helpful to see what the consensus is when nobody is being influenced by each other. There's actually a really interesting book about this called The Wisdom of Crowds by James Surowiecki. So that's something I found really helpful. Another thing that I found really helpful was to think about how I can make use of all the feedback that I'm getting. So for example, I had great feedback from beta readers in the manuscripts where people would give me their comments and suggestions as track changes, using the track changes feature. But what I also found was that people were writing back in their emails to me, and they were giving me a lot of really useful thoughts and ideas and their own impressions of the book. And I wanted to make sure that I was able to use that feedback. So I used it in two ways. Where they made suggestions that were like developmental edits in their email, I put those in the bug tracker, and I made sure I reviewed those. But also, people gave me a lot of really great feedback in terms of their impressions as readers. And what I did was I made sure that I captured those quotes and comments. And when I released the book at the end of last week, I was able to email the beta readers individually and ask for reviews. And I was able to remind each one of them about what it was that they had written to me about the book and give them their own text. Because it just makes it a lot easier for people to write a review if they remember what they thought about the book and so forth. So that helped me, because one of the key things for any book upon release is getting reviews as quickly as possible. And I wanted to get as many reviews as possible. I've got 13 now, but I do want to say, if you would like to read my book, please do leave a review. It really helps. I've deliberately not made the book expensive because I want it to get out there. And it's great if you can buy a copy, but if you would like to read a copy and you want to give me a review for your blog or for Amazon itself, I'm happy to give you a review copy. So just email me at jake@thevoluntarylife.com and I will give you a review copy for free. So I hope you found that interesting. I'm really proud of my new book. A huge amount of work has gone into it, and I believe that it can help you achieve real freedom in your life. So I hope you found it helpful hearing about the book and the process of getting crowdsourced feedback. That's all for this week. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you for listening to The Voluntary Life. If you have feedback about the show, please email jake@thevoluntarylife.com. If you enjoyed this program, please share the podcast with your friends or click the donate button on thevoluntarylife.com.